that when I go to Francophone countries where they don't have common English common law, they always have a problem, but they also invoke things like other forms that are a replica of a trust law. The second stage is where the telcos and banks move to the next stage, and they developed and partnered and developed platforms that provided virtual savings account. That is, you can use you could use your bank account, you can use your mobile phone, and actually send money to your own personal account, and you can use your mobile phone to withdraw or even to save. Then it means that you don't have to take a trip to the bank. Then it means that you don't have to take a trip to the bank either to withdraw or to save or to withdraw. And this is the beginning of the virtual banking service in Kenya. But the third stage is more interesting because the banks themselves or that platform started, the virtual platform started using transactions data and savings data to generate credit scores for use as the basis to evaluate the and price short-term credit. And for us, the supply of credit using credit scores actually it changes or transforms the costly collateral technology that we have has been used for many years. Especially in developing countries and in Africa especially, developments in the credit market has been problematic just because of the collateral technology, has been problematic because of information asymmetry. And the fact that you can actually use that platform to build information capital becomes very, very important. It gives us hope that we can actually move the financial system into the next level. And the fourth one is the developments in cross-border payments and even international remittances. We all have used Western Union to send money back home. But when you said use Western Union, then you also have to visit the bank, provide all the details of who is sending the money, and then you receive the money, and then you go home. But you don't have to do that anymore. It can come straight into your mobile phone. And that means that you can solve so many problems. You can see that between Tanzania and Rwanda, you have Tigo Pesa. So essentially, you can actually communicate. So this is the start of seeing that even businesses across the borders will use mobile phone to transact and to provide, to facilitate e-commerce, and that is trade. Facilitating trade is very, very important. I say this because when we started the East African payment system, and the East African community is a very cohesive group, is a very nice group, and trade takes place, we realize that with the East African payment system using local currencies, this was still inhibited by convertibility of currencies. Now, you can see that this is something that we need to overcome. It's a question of how do we come up with the regulatory flexibility and even reforms to support that. So what I wanted to show is that regulatory flexibility, reforms, and even capacity that is required can be a catalyst in terms of the evolution of payment system, financial inclusion, and even endogenous development in the financial system. And that is how the Kenyan story of M-Pesa started and how it has endogenously developed. So that's why we say we can come back and talk about now inclusive growth, financial development, and we can talk about e-commerce. And we hope that can be replicated across countries in developing world, because this is where the binding constraint actually hurts most and frustrates trade. Having provided that, we can actually even talk about commerce. First is accessibility. Transactions is always the entry point into the any banking sector. Why we talk about financial inclusion first is actually transactions. You won't perform transactions in the banking sector. But if you cannot access that, then it means that you have to use cash. The second is that retail payment system have emerged. One of the things and some of the studies that I have looked at is actually they show that the Kenyans' retail payment under the mobile phone financial system that started almost like 8 years ago has been described as efficient, effective, transparent, it's real-time, and it's safe. And that, for us, is very, very important. We didn't have, of course, companies have to advertise very heavily. Third, commercial banks that did not even have technology to manage microaccounts all of a sudden found a ready technology platform to deal with microaccounts. Personal savings have increased. But somebody commented the other time and said that personal investments have not increased. Why? because these are still microsavers. Then we need a special purpose vehicle to help these microsavers invest. But the other also, there's also another problem. Some studies that have been conducted at household level shows that in times of shocks, those families that have saved actually are better off after the shocks because they end up, they do not devour their assets. So essentially, we still need to come up with a program of how to encourage investment through those savings. Poor people are very efficient in terms of savings investment cycles. So it's a question of how to keep the supply of investment opportunities alive, that is the vibrancy of the economy. Banks have built mountains of deposit, and this has given them power to intermediate in the economy. That's why when you hear about Kenyan banks, they have covered the East African region very effectively. It's because they have the power. They have been given that power to intermediate. We have about 11 banks in Kenya which have covered, which have over 300 branches in the branch outlets in the East African region. Fourth, we all know that if you lower costs of financial services and even lower cost of transactions because unit costs can come down, then it means that you have actually encouraged financial inclusion. And also because the mobile phone solves the physical distance. And finally, we have supported trade. And this is quite clear in terms of how transactions are taking place. SMEs, households are finding that very appropriate. And even credit facilities that have developed within the ecosystem. So essentially, we can show that M-Pesa has led to financial inclusion. Financial inclusion has supported e-commerce. And that is, for us, a very, very important outcome that we can look at. And now, I don't have to emphasize Kenya's DFS case because, Mr. Chairman, we can actually look at the slides. But the most important thing is that we always forget the role of government. You cannot succeed in financial inclusion and even in the digital system if the government is not actually participating in the e-commerce, in the electronic system. We cannot succeed. And I think this is where I think I became one of the bad boys by saying that we are not going to allow cash payments by the central bank to the government ministries. Use electronic funds transfer, use the RTGS, you can pay everybody through the banking system. But the most important thing is that in developing countries, the government is the major player, is the major employer, and the major payer. So if it doesn't pay, things go slow. But the most important thing is that if it adopts the digital financial system, digitization, if the government is digitized, then you're going to succeed in digitization and even in e-commerce. And we're happy about Kenya. In fact, I was so happy that one time we had a major shock in terms of drought, and the government used M-Pesa to target poor households and provide social protection through payments, through payments. And we have to ask ourselves, in most cases, we would like to provide subsidies to specific income groups or to specific sectors in the economy. The only efficient way that it can be done is to come up with a gateway, a payment gateway, that is going to target those specific people. Anyway, yeah, let me wrap it up by showing some graphs. This one, I don't have to emphasize, it is actually the journey for financial inclusion. Why I always emphasize it, because when financial inclusion is low and you don't trust the system, then you find that informal finance is the one that takes the lion's share. And you can see in Kenya, informal finance from 2006 to 2016 has been crushed. And that for us is very, very important. From 32% to about 17%, to about 7.2% in terms of preference of financial inclusion. But the success or the DFS-supported financial inclusion is seen to work. And in countries that have data, luckily we have FSD, Financial Sector Deepening Trust, that has been funded by many funders, including DFID and Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. They are conducting all these surveys across the globe in developing countries, and they are showing similar results. At the regional level, Kenya has done very well and is running third in the region, taking off from Mauritius and South Africa. And of course, this is the one that I like. How do you provide financial services at the doorstep? we look at it in terms of access, financial access touch points. You can see, I've compared Kenya with some competitors, and you can see how it is doing. Within 5 kilometers, we have even tested this within 2 kilometers radius, and how much service points do you have? That is very, very important. If we are going to talk about e-commerce, we are going to talk about e-commerce because you are supported by access, financial access touch points, and that is very, very important. But there are some lessons. I'm a strong defender of institutions. I'm a strong defender of regulations, but better institutions. Institutions are going to define the appropriate incentives, and they also draw down the rules of the game. And then that is where financial deepening has come in. And of course, that's we're trying to say that if you have better regulations, you have better institutions that define the rules of the game and also define the appropriate incentives, then e-commerce will be facilitated and trade at national and regional level and even international levels will be efficient. E-commerce outcomes, for me, it's a wider development the e-commerce is going to give us a wider development outcome. And especially developing economies would like to have these wider development outcomes. Because that's the only way we are going to solve some of the binding constraints at household level and SME levels. And we know that even governments themselves suffer because of low tax bases. Those low tax bases are because essentially we are not opening up some development areas or even development outcomes that the country needs. But I have to still wear my hat, other hat of this body of knowledge is expanding. My other hat is that I'm from academia. And one of them is the body of knowledge in this area is expanding. One of the latest contribution that I've made is actually how to use transformative technology to support the environment, especially financial inclusion. And the other one is actually showing how households and SMEs are cashing in on digital revolution. So we also have studies that have been that have covered financial regulation for financial inclusion. And this is to allow you to show that the body of knowledge is expanding. So essentially, developing countries cannot have an excuse not to push this policy frontier, public policy for financial inclusion that is going to support e-commerce. Thank you very much for listening to me.
Asante sana, Professor. I do have to confess that my expectations fell rather short to what your presentation has been, even if we're going to have to cut our coffee time short. You should come more often to Geneva, I think. Now we would like to have Mr. Ali Sarfraz as a representative from the private sector and Mr. Hamid Mamdouh with the point of view of an international organization. So Ali, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the fascinating presentation. An M-Pesa story obviously has been looked at, studied, and provides an inspiration to a number of countries. In Pakistan also, the country is looking at increasing financial inclusion. But I would like to point out, and you've mentioned the journeys, and in fact, every country has its own journey. What we believe is because how the market evolved over the years and developed actually has an influence how the financial services and specifically digital financial services are used by the consumers. Now in Pakistan, prior to the regulator was very active, as you've mentioned, so we check on one of the ingredients. The central bank actually came up with the branchless banking regulations, which formed the basis in 2007. But there were six mobile players in the market. And one by one, all of them jumped into offering the digital financial services. Now, they were after the same network of agents, which meant that the margins were really, really low because the market could not absorb almost 8 wallets that were being offered. And what has happened over the last 2 to 3 years that now there are 3 active players in the market which have almost, and 2 of them have combined 90% of the market share. And the remaining offer the service because as a telco, they have to be there. Hence, what has happened is those who have the agents have relied on that. They have remained closed loop. They don't open up. The 2 main players in offering digital financial services want to play the same game that they played as a telco. They want the transactions to be on net, and they don't want to go off net. This was the same experience they had as a telco, and they're repeating the same experience as a digital financial service provider. Interestingly, some of the stages that you have mentioned, they have jumped on that. And one of the important things is offering micro-saving products, and also some of them are now planning to start and offering digital credit. And here I would like to highlight, there are a number of policy challenges and issues, but one very important policy level decision that has to be made by the regulators is in terms of the digital credit. A digital credit, they use all the data, they use the CDR records in order to do credit scoring and then determine within seconds whether the person is going to get credit or not and offer digital credit. Now, this product will be targeted towards those who are poor, also those who are in the lower income groups. But the digital credit would be offered for, let's say, a month. And they will have to pay back within, let's say, another month. And the annual effective rates would actually be astronomical. And one of the things that the regulator has looked at, they have not tried to regulate the interest rates, but what they've tried to do is see how the market plays out. And offering those digital credit, the regulators need to be cognizant of the fact that they do not become a payday loan, because that's the real risk in case of digital credit. While we are on this journey of financial inclusion, obviously, as you mentioned, e-commerce is playing a big role. And I have a presentation in the next session specifically highlighting those issues. Thank you very much.
Shukriya Ali. I would like now to share the floor with Hamid.
Thank you very much, Alvaro, and good morning, everyone. And let me first thank you for inviting me to the session and congratulate Professor Ndungu for a wonderful presentation. It's a very, very nice story about policy and regulatory coherence across sectors. And what I would try to do in 10 minutes is to look at the trade policy agenda in this discussion and what contribution could trade policy make, but also highlight some of the WTO rules that are very relevant to these sectors that we're talking about. Now, of course, in the core of this discussion is connectivity, and connectivity basically, whether it's physical or digital, is about having the hardware, having the software, and having the service supplied in a competitive environment. Now, as I said, a very, very interesting aspect of all this is the policy coherence and the regulatory coherence that would be necessary to achieve success in the area of financial inclusion. And the sectors that we're talking about in particular here are the financial services sector, the telecommunications sector, and the distribution sector as well, and perhaps many other sectors depending on what kind of transaction we're looking at. But I will focus in my comments in particular with respect to WTO rules on these two important sectors, finance and telecommunications. Now, before I get into these two sectors and their specificity and how the GATS rules actually look at them, I would just make a point about the development approach that the GATS, as the multilateral agreement on international trade and services, take. The GATS takes an approach to development which is different from the traditional approach of special and differential treatment that we've been used to since the early 60s, that looks at the treatment of developing countries as providing flexibility in the application of trade obligations. The GATS actually takes a different approach. It does provide flexibility, but in a different way, but it also provides a positive agenda. On the flexibility side, the GATS does not apply the concept of special and differential treatment in a one-size-fits-all as under the GATT in merchandise trade, but it It replaced it with flexibility for individual developing countries. So each developing country would tailor its own flexibility with respect to its regulatory and development needs according to its own situation. And I think Ali mentioned just now that each country has its own story. And of course, there are idiosyncrasies and specificities in each and every market. So that's an important thing, that flexibility here can be tailored. And that informed the architecture of the agreement, the GATS itself, which relies to a very large extent on individual schedules to determine the extent to which each country would undertake commitments and under which conditions. The positive agenda I refer to here, which is very important to this discussion, is what you will find in Article Follow the GATS about how to increase the participation of developing countries in world services trade. And it's the first time in any trade agreement that the agreement itself recognizes that an important part of that story is the commitments, the market openings that developing countries themselves undertake in certain sectors in order to boost their own domestic and indigenous capacities. A perfect example in that respect, which we have experienced over the past 20 years, of course, is the telecommunications sector. I don't think any developing country sitting here in the room today would have developed this telecommunications sector to where it is today if it hadn't opened its market to the big telecommunication operators to bring their capital, their investment, participation in infrastructure development, their state-of-the-art technology, which allowed the kind of leapfrogging that that we've been hearing about, as well as the know-how of management. How do you manage a telecommunications operator in a competitive market? Now, without that kind of market opening, it's very difficult for developing countries to actually to apply the same approach that we were used to in the old days on manufacturing, for example, that you close your market until you become more competitive and you start liberalizing your inputs gradually. It doesn't work like that in services. And that is very, very important. I would refer you to Article 4 of the GATS itself, which looks at how to promote the participation of developing countries through commitments by different members, i.e. including developing countries themselves, in order to provide them access to information channels, to distribution networks, access to technology, and finally to provide access to other markets where developing countries have export interest in sectors and modes of supply that where they have export capacity. Now, we keep that in mind, and then we move to the two important sectors that we're looking at, telecommunications and financial services. These have all along have been considered to be very important and very peculiar sectors under the GATS in the context of trade and services, and that's why we have a sectoral annex to the GATS for each of them. And let me start with the telecommunications annex. The interesting thing, although the GATS was drafted way back in the early 90s, I was 12 years old at the time, it starts by recognizing the dual nature of the telecommunications sector as a significant sector of economic activity in its own right and as a carrier for other services. So this concept of the telecommunications sector is the highway for the delivery of products is well ingrained in the system from the very beginning. But it goes further to also recognize the importance of data flows, information flows in the supply of services, which I think from the professor's presentation, it is really part of the backbone for financial inclusion. And I would refer you to paragraph 5 of the telecommunications annex, which actually establishes a legal obligation on WTO members to allow the use of, or to ensure the use of public telecommunications networks and services for the transmission and processing of information within and across borders. This is relevant to the discussion we're having today about cross-border data flows. Now, of course, the annex also recognizes that members may need to regulate data flows for whatever situation it may find that necessary to pursue any of the legitimate policy objectives. Now, that gives us a framework of how the telecommunications sector actually represents a backbone for a number of activities, not the least for financial services. Moving to the financial services part of the GATS, and particularly the annex, we will see that the annex recognizes also that financial services is the lifeblood of any economies. And from the professor's presentation this morning, we also see that it is a backbone of poverty reduction, social development, how to help small and medium-sized enterprises. Without a sound and strong financial services sector, no economy actually can have any kind of liftoff in any respect. Now, the annex is very useful in the sense that it gives us a picture about what kind of regulatory measures we would be looking at from a services trade perspective. And that feeds into what the professor said earlier about regulatory flexibility and regulatory intervention and the role of governments in not only designing financial inclusion policies, but also in implementing them in regulatory frameworks. And there we can look at four types of measures, of government intervention. The first is measures that relate to monetary and exchange rate policy, which the annex says clearly that this is outside the scope of the GATS, so no interference by the GATS in that respect at all. The second is prudential measures, any measures that are taken for prudential reasons, which are also subject to a very important exception provision in the telecom, in the financial services annex, which basically says financial regulators may take whatever measures that they see appropriate for financial prudential reasons. And then the second, which we can extrapolate from the GATS framework, is those measures that are considered to be market access and national treatment barriers, which are the subject of negotiations and the scheduling of commitments. And then finally, the fourth is this vast area of what we call domestic regulation. It's how you regulate the sector. Now, if we look at those four areas, we will see that, that the GATS and the negotiation of commitments under the GATS is designed to address and control only the third one, which is market access and national treatment restrictions. For the rest, the regulators, be it in telecommunications or in financial services, would actually pursue the policies and the regulatory agendas that they wish, as long as the domestic regulatory requirements are non-discriminatory, i.e. in the MFN sense or in the national treatment sense if you don't have, if you have a national treatment commitment. Now, why is that interesting for financial inclusion? Because, as we heard, for governments to promote financial inclusion policies, it would be necessary in many instances to provide incentives or impose requirements. And someone might say, yes, but if you provide incentives, you might distort. If you impose requirements, you might restrict. But actually, if you do that in a non-discriminatory way, by and large, you would be consistent with the rules. The question is to find the right answer to the questions that you're facing in a particular situation. But the GATS would provide the kind of support by negotiating commitments. Now, why are commitments interesting? And why? And I'll go back to Article 4, why? Because they provide the kind of stability and predictability in the market which attracts strong suppliers and operators. It attracts investment. It enhances the transparency of your market and market operations. It enhances competitive conditions, which actually lead eventually to the kind of welfare gains and competitiveness gains that we're looking for. And that is the stimulus that that the sector would get in order to advance forward. And we heard earlier examples to that. So, the message here, and let me wrap up, is that you look at the GATS and you look at the trade policy agenda there, you will see the stimulants provided in the negotiation of commitments, tailored commitments. But also, you can look at the flexibilities and see that there is a lot of elbow room to work and pursue those policies in a way that would suit each country's situation. And hopefully, the WTO would be there to play its role in that respect. And let me stop here. Thank you.
Shukran Hamid, e-commerce for development needs you. So thank you very much for being here. I am conscious of time, and we want to have at least a short conversation with you. I know we have a second session starting at 11:45, and we want to start on time. So I would like to offer you, if you're desperate for coffee, there is coffee outside, but we would like to open the floor now if you have questions, comments, doubts that you would like to raise to the panelists. Please let us know your affiliation and your name so that we can identify who you are. The floor is open. Yes, please.
Thank you very much, and good morning. My name is Natalia Porras from the Ministry of Foreign Trade of Costa Rica. My question is to Mr. Mahmoud. You were talking about all the elbow room when drafting commitments, but sometimes in practice, we do see that there's a very gray line between the prudential measure and the commitment itself with regards to market access. And I think that sometimes it does have an influence on the decision to undertake a commitment. So I would appreciate your comments on how to distinguish this gray line, and in order to promote market access commitments and useful market access commitments to the country without leaving behind this elbow room with regards to prudential measures.
Do we have one or two more comments? Yes, please.
Hello, Dorothée Delors from the World Bank. I have a question regarding telecom providers, because in some case, they are both carriers and service providers themselves, and they can be in competition with banks and restrict access to banks to some of their services, like USSD channels. So I would like to have an idea of what kind of rules the World Trade Organization would recommend in that case where you both are a carrier and a provider yourself. That would be my first question. And then there's another question, which is in these services, the licensing and regulation is domestic, but the service can be cross-border. So how do you recognize the licensing that has been done by another country and allow cross-border service? This is also something on which I would welcome your views as WTO.
Ambassador Karau, abhari azugoy.
Mzuri sana. How are you? Thank you so much. Very exciting morning. Thank you very much, Waziri Mora, for a very inspiring talk. My question is to Professor Ndungu, my compatriot, and I am referring to the very inspirational talk again by Minister Mora, asking us to look 12 years from now. I know the African Union is also looking at many years from now, 2063, but I want to come nearer home and put up a very simple question. You did mention currency, I hope I can pronounce this word, convertibility as being a barrier. I want to know how far we are from the East African shilling. I know we are all trading with the shilling. We have the Kenya shilling, Tanzania shilling, Ugandan shilling. And one time we used to have one currency. So even as we target the Afro for the whole of Africa, given the regional basis that you said we start with individual, regional, and then continental, how far are we from the East African shilling, and why is it so difficult to get it back? Thank you.
Okay, I say we start with Hamid, and then we share the floor with Professor.
Thank you. The first question with respect to prudential measures, I think, of course, there will always, in any legal provision, be borderline cases, of course, and that would be subject to interpretations and jurisprudence as we go along, and we started having some jurisprudence on the prudential exception, and it provides some clarity. But if we look at the provision itself and look at it as an exception provision, looking at the legal standards of exceptions in trade agreements, you find that this actually provides a very considerable latitude of flexibility. The exception there does not actually define any particular types of prudential measures that you can take. Prudential measures are defined in terms of their objectives, and it says basically you may take any measure for prudential reasons, and prudential reasons are described as protecting depositors, policyholders, or any person to whom a fiduciary duty is owed. And then the only thing it says at the end is that you should not use prudential measures as a means of avoiding your obligations and commitments. It's not like the general exceptions provision where it has a necessity test that the measure has to be necessary and measured and evaluated in terms of what alternatives would you have had if not this measure. So there is a great deal of latitude. And it is designed for prudential reasons, i.e. to protect the stability and integrity of your financial system. And if there is a link, basically, between the measure and the objectives, I would say you're probably in a good place. I wouldn't say you won't be challenged. No, nobody can ever guarantee that. But you would certainly be in a good place. So there is really a good elbow room there. Now, the evidence of the past 22 years is that we've had only one case that raised a question about the prudential exception, although it's being used every day. So we are probably in a good place there. This does not, of course, preclude the fact that any questions may be raised in the Services Council for clarification, for discussion. We've even done some secretariat work on that. If it is something that requires more clarification in light of market developments or new regulatory innovations, then, of course, there would be ample room for them. Now, the interesting question about telecom operators and banks and the fact that they're competing together, modern technology and business innovation has actually faced us with a question that comes up in many instances with respect to business models. And there, I would say, in order to see our way through those different types of business models, like Uber, for example, or Airbnb, or e-payments in this respect, when we look at it from a GATS perspective, we should always keep in mind that the GATS addresses services as products. We follow the central product classification system, which looks at each and every service as a product. So you have a banking service, you have a telecommunication service. It's like Uber, and this is where a distinction between what a product is and a business model that may combine several products in one business model would be very helpful. If you look at Uber, for example, you have a package of services. You have transport, you have a placing service, you have a payment service, you have sometimes insurance service. So that's a business model. But when you look at it from a trade perspective and look at services as products, you would need to break down that business model into specific products. So to go back to your question, we will, from a GATS perspective, still look at your commitments on telecommunication services, your commitments on payment services, and the fact that these business models are developed and regulated in a given market would be the function of the regulator to sort this out and see what would be the business models that would be allowed because in some countries Uber is not allowed, period. It doesn't mean that transport services are not allowed or payment services are not allowed. It's just that business model that is not allowed. And I suspect that we're going to see an increasing number of those kind of examples that might lead us to this trap of confusing business models with products. But the answers, if you break it down, I think would probably be clearer. The question about licensing being domestic and services cross-border, that would always be the case. This is why we face this phenomenon today. We're in an increasingly globalizing world while regulation continues to be local. And the only bridge between the two is international cooperation. That's why we need to look at those problems and those issues in the context, for example, of the negotiations on domestic regulation or even in other negotiations under the GATS, which may produce the kind of regulatory disciplines that provide solutions for some of those problems or set certain regulatory standards that would help regulators in the different jurisdictions move in a similar direction. Our experience, our successful experience in that respect, obviously, is the telecommunications sector, where we negotiated those regulatory principles in the reference paper about the establishment of an independent regulator, how you deal with interconnection fees, how you deal with interconnection in general, how do you deal with dominant suppliers, and so on. So you're putting your finger on a very, very important issue, but I think it will cut across almost most of what we will do in the future with these technologies and business models. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor.
Thank you very much, and thank you for that response on my paper as well as that response on, we have had those problems about even at the domestic level in terms of regulation. PESA, is it a telco product or is it a bank product? But from a regulatory point of view from the central bank, we are actually, it's a product, it's a bank product which has characteristics, or is a business model which has very peculiar characteristics because of the transmission. So essentially we have had those problems. Even countries that want to replicate it always comes back and say, how do you allow telcos to deal with money products? And this kind of differentiation is very important. Now, Ambassador Karau's point, thank you very much. You know, the East African community is one of those regional integration parks in Africa which has really which has advanced very well. It has its own timetables. And to answer your question, the East African currency, single currency, is supposed to come in force in 2024. But the thing is, before that, we needed to have some institutions that will be guiding the process. One of the most important institutions was the East African Monetary Institute. And the other one was the East African Surveillance, which would be regulating banks. But unfortunately, those have not taken off. So essentially, we are still waiting for that, because I think there were some few problems with the political scene, with Burundi having some civil strife and all that. But the most important thing is that the central banks in the region, what they decided was, let's come together and provide some quick wins to facilitate trade. And one of the first quick wins was actually East African payment system. Then we realized that the trade facilitation was not working well, because you are supposed to fund your accounts in different countries with local currencies. You needed to come up with a very active currency convertibility program. Unfortunately, currency convertibility program, you have to actually deliver currencies physically into central banks. And of course, we signed the agreements about you can clear any balances or clear any excesses and all that. But we wanted to start with Kenya and Tanzania because we are close by to each other, Arusha and Nairobi. But I don't know why it has stalled. But I think these are the quick wins that we wanted. So ahead of 2024, we thought as central banks is that what we thought was that once you come up with convertibility model, then over time you can develop a new mirror that would help you in terms of having a single currency. But I'm sure that is on track. By 2024, we're going to see that result. So essentially, even though trade is very, very active between the countries and even cross-border. But we thought that that would be the one that would help us quite greatly. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. In sake of time, I would like to wrap up this session. The next one starts in 3 minutes, so I think we all deserve to stretch our legs a little bit. I wish to thank sincerely the speakers very much. I want to thank you all here for filling up the room. I've seen it's difficult to find an empty chair today. And it's been a wonderful start of the seminar, a wonderful start of the day, and a wonderful start of the week. So thank you very much. And there is still coffee outside. We start again in 3 minutes. Thank you.